Say what again? Say what again? I dare you. I double dare you.
What we got here is a failure to communicate.
Welcome to the Uncommon Communicator podcast. Your hosts James Gable and Brandon Thompson are here to bring you enlightenment to the topic of communication. Today is a little bit different, however. So normally it's just James and I hunkered down in the Uncommon Communicator bunker, dare we call it a basement. And we have a third party today, James. Would you care to introduce this third party?
Absolutely. I am honored. We are honored to have Jesse Hernandez, the Uncommon Communicator. He's the construction whisperer.
You call him like the wizard of the whisperer, right?
I like wizard. I like that idea as well, too. But Jesse, and we're going to have him introduce himself, and we're going to get to know him today. But I met Jesse a couple months ago, just on a whim, when we started our podcast. I said, hey, Jesse, I could use some advice. And without even hesitating, he jumps in and says, absolutely. And we met, like, what time? 5 a.m. I'm like, okay. It was like super early. So we met, we really had a connection at that point. And then just, you know, as destiny has it, I'm on his podcast like mm-hmm. that next morning. I'm like, I guess I'm ready. So that's how we had kind of met and just how destiny kind of gets us to that point. But today we have Jesse as our guest. And Jesse Hernandez, please introduce yourself.
Oh, man, this is, like, not fair because I'm used to being the one asking the questions, right? So everyone knows me as Jesse. My name is Jesus Hernandez. I'm a podcasting, salsa dancing, book writing, second generation plumber / social media mogul.
There you go, man.
How's that?
That's it. Can you print that on a business card?
That probably already is. You write it, you become it. Well, Jesse, we're excited to have you here. And you know, our theme is the Uncommon Communicator. And we certainly have seen in you and in your podcast and in the people that you've been reaching and connecting with have absolutely been on an uncommon level. Incredible growth, incredible connection. So we're honored to have you here. You are our first live guest. So we're excited about having you. And so as we make our mistakes, we'll make you look better today. So the one question that we always want to ask is, and it sounds familiar, I might have stole this from just a media mogul podcaster, but what do you want the world to know about Jesse Hernandez?
Oh, man. What I want the world to know is, you know, I just introduced myself. I was being goofy and silly, kind of, right? There's also kind of a little hope and truth to it, more hope than truth. Yeah. Well, what I'd like the world to know is whatever impression they're getting or whatever value they're experiencing from the podcast or the Learnings of Missteps podcast or the live streams with Jennifer Lacey is that all we're doing is we have an idea and we're putting it into play. And I spent a couple of decades, you know, wrestling with coming up with the perfect plan and, you know, step by step and milestones and all this stuff. And all that really did was suffocate whatever it was in my head to the point that most of them never came to fruition. When I finally got to a point in my life to have the courage to put myself out there, to be laughed at, to be snickered at, to be judged, to be critiqued, that's when things started just blasting off. I mean, the podcast we've had for, I don't know, 16 months now, and it was just kind of a random experiment and see how long it lasts. And it's not going away. And that's turned into live streams and interviews, and, you know, I'm connected with you all. And none of that would have happened had those ideas been getting polished and massaged and redone and perfected. None of that would have happened without that. So really, whatever image comes across is really just a matter of having an idea, getting it as close to actionable as possible, and then putting the damn thing out into the universe, and the rest takes care of itself.
Now, one thing that I guess everybody needs to know, like the power of words, the power of typed words, right? Ooh. You made an offhanded comment, not really offhanded. You'd made a comment in a gimbal walk. I did a $5 gimbal. I don't know how you guys make money at that.
Oh, yeah.
$5 gimbal walk. And Jesse was part of a team that was presenting this, this presentation on lean, just really you watched, make improvements by watching it, the work unfold.
Yeah, yeah.
So he, future podcaster, right? or I think you were podcasting at that point. And so just made that comment and they just kind of put it aside. And then I, went and looked and found it. But then when you talked about putting yourself out there, that becoming uncomfortable is when change happens. So Adam Hoots, so because of this, I get connected with Jesse, reading LinkedIn, posts and stuff like that. Well, Adam Hoots makes a comment about, because he made a change, he just went out all in as well, too, to go into coaching and leaving his kind of day job and made this comment like, man, I just made the move, right? And you were part of that, Jesse, because he told me that was... You're like, why are you waiting to build it? Like, just go do it and it'll come. It's almost like that Field of Dreams, right?
Build it, they will come.
It was a word that was in a LinkedIn comment that made me reach out to you to say, let's do this. So those are the power of connection that Jesse has brought to me and to just tons of people. And Adam, it's amazing the power of that communication. What influenced you to make that step?
Oh, man. So this is like straight up real stuff. I've wrestled with addiction for probably 2/3 of my life. And the last wrestling match, I've been sober 5.5 years now. It was one of our counselors. Thank you.
Yeah.
One of the counselors, he said to me, Jess, you don't have a problem admitting, you have a problem accepting. And I'm like, man, what are you doing playing around with words? And to your point, right, words are powerful. Mm-hmm. And he's like, no. He's like, you have no problem saying, my name's Jesse and I'm an addict or I'm an alcoholic or whatever. He said, what you have a problem with is accepting. I was like, okay, you're not saying anything different to me. And he says, your problem is you have not accepted that if you continue to live life the way you're living it, you will not become the promise you're intended to be.
Mm. Hmm.
And that, like, when he said that, it was like a 2x4 between the eyes because I couldn't articulate it then, but I could absolutely feel what he was talking about. All of those, hungover mornings, all of those kind of regretful, kind of hazy flashbacks. I felt like, what am I doing? Why am I only doing this? Why am I like stuck in this loop of repeat? And it was almost like a personal disappointment because I wasn't doing what I could do. But then there's that head garbage, right, that tells me, get over yourself. You're living in imagination. And so the accepting and it wasn't about accepting that I couldn't use or drink or any of that. It was accepting that if I continue to live life the way I was living it. And so then it caused me to question, how am I living my life? And the fact was, I was exerting so much damn energy in to define everything, to measure everything, to control everything. And so in that period of time, I decided that control is an illusion. At best, I can influence things and I've got to release control in order to become the promise I'm intended to be. And so by releasing control, I had to get vulnerable. I had to say or speak or act in the direction I was called. And that called for like immense vulnerability. Mm-hmm. And the first few times I did it was like little baby steps, little, thoughts and ideas I had and they didn't blow up. The world didn't end. I didn't hurt anybody. So I did a little bit more. I got a little more courageous. And then we talked about a little while ago. Now we're having some pretty deep damn discussions, Jennifer and I, live. 5.5 years ago, there ain't no way that was going to happen. If I got to track back to like pinpoint a very specific time, it was that.
Wow, that's amazing. You know, and we talked a little bit about, and it's great that you're so open about that addiction, because that is what, just like the name of your podcast is what? Learning and Missteps. So that in its own is admitting those things and talking about that and having people grow from that. And when you talk about your addiction and the other things like that, you know, that was another connection that you and I had had as well. Not that I've had addictions, but I grew up in a family, a construction family of alcoholics. You know, those are the things. And there's a whole, you know, as you know, Jesse, I'm sure, like you start talking about addictions and stuff, it really becomes this kind of dark secret, you know, world that nobody wants to talk about. But it also changes your psyche. It changes how you think, how you reason, how you become, especially being a, you know, a kid in that. But when he started sharing this and sharing his coming out of that, that connected with me as well, too. Like you talk a lot about now vulnerabilities, right? And those are things I think why I hold those in, and that's why I hear you talk about those things, and they're kind of powerful for me. Talking about the learning and missteps, was that driven on you wanting to kind of be open with yourself, or what drove that name and the purpose of your podcast?
Yeah, so the podcast, the purpose of the podcast is to enhance the image of careers in the trades. I mentioned I'm a second generation plumber. It's been a long, long time since I had my tools on, but I experienced an amazing life as a result of choosing a career in the trades. That early decision was difficult because the message that I had subscribed to was go to college or you fail. Mm-hmm. Anyhow, fast forward, I'm a mogul, right? Here I am with you guys. Like, come on,
college
man.
Degree, I'm a media mogul. There you go.
So that's the purpose of the podcast. Now, what launched it was the pandemic. You know, I was in a traveling role. We had a travel ban, no more traveling, had to sit at home. And so what I did most of the time, like a way that I would give back and kind of gain some fulfillment outside of work was speaking to students and parents and educators about careers in the industry. Well, when the lockdown happened, none of that was, so like that was entirely stripped away from my life. And a friend of mine recommended I watch the, like a documentary on Danny Trejo. And he doesn't talk about podcasts. But what I took from that thing was he's an actor. His goal is not to be an A-list actor. He's acting to get paid so that he could spread and share his message. Mm-hmm. And I said, well, I ain't got no excuse. I had been interviewed on my friend Adam Gates. He's got a podcast. He interviewed me local in San Antonio. So I called up Adam like, hey, bro, like I need to start a podcast. Walk me through. See, similar, you know, he's got this gear. He's like, dude, you don't even need this gear anymore. You could just use Teams because everything's virtual now. Like, yeah, I got all the stuff. Like these headsets. I've had these headsets. And the reason I have them is they're red. It's a form of visual management because when I'm on a call, you know, people like to hover and you're on a call or like, I'm on a call. Like red tells you stop, go away. Like that's the intent.
I'm in an open office. I need that. Go ahead.
It's, you know, if I have earbuds and they can't see that. So they think I'm listening to music or whatever. So anyhow, I've had these for years. And then when I'm planning the podcast, I'm like, man, I got all the gear I need. So I'm still running on the original headset, my laptop, blah, blah, blah. And so that's what like launched it. Now the name was a challenge because I know that I wanted to provide a different image of construction workers and people that built careers in the industry. And I also needed it to have meaning such that it could expand outside of that when the opportunity presented itself. So wrestled back and forth. I'm like, you know, just kind of examining my life and how I got to where I was and where I am. It is through a series of learnings and missteps, right? Like the deepest, my best teachers are pain and failure. And when I spend time with them, I got a lot of learning going on. And the only time I really spend time with them is when I'm making some severe missteps.
Yeah, I feel that. So one of our other questions that we have is, what's your favorite like communication tool, or, you know, what's your favorite one, or what's the one you find most effective? You talked a lot about vulnerability. Do you view vulnerability as a communication tool, or is that just kind of more of your communication style?
Ooh, that's a really great question. So I'll start with the tool first, because I got two of them.
Okay.
And those are my ears.
There you go. All right. You got two ears, one mouth.
Yeah, and I like to share this thought, right? There's a lot of folks, there's a lot of training and seminars and coaching that's about public speaking and presenting yourself and getting your message across. And there's so many resources that are available to help people move their mouth more. There's very little resources available to help people learn how to like do that less. Mm-hmm. And so in communication, there's two things that have to happen. One person has to convey a message. Another person has to receive a message. And I mean, if you look at the times we're in right now, people are just louder and louder and louder, and everybody's got their opinion out there, and people are screaming and yelling. And that's what happens when people don't listen. People just talk louder. You see it in meetings, you see it on the job site, you see it at the gas station. And so it sounds pretty like elementary, right? You got, like you said, you got two ears, one mouth, listen twice as much, but listening is not easy. So back to the vulnerability, I don't know how to categorize it. Maybe it'll clarify as I'm speaking, but in order for me to listen, that like the elementary level, the kindergarten level is me not talking. Mm-hmm. That may not necessarily be listening. I'm just not talking. Mm-hmm. It looks like listening. For me to help someone feel like I am listening to them, there's a lot of things that need to happen. And so this is where vulnerability starts coming into play. Because one, I have to disassociate myself from all of my thoughts, all of the calculus that I'm running and trying to respond and give them the right answer and give them advice, or, you know, share, relate to them and give them my story. They don't want to hear that. They didn't come to me for me to tell them about me. Like right now, y'all gave me this opportunity to talk about me. That's rare. When people come to me or to you, they want to talk about their favorite subject, and their favorite subject is them. Mm-hmm. And so what we need to do is be, like, I don't know if it's intuitive or empathetic or whatever the hell it is. The vulnerability comes in, okay, I'm going to disconnect myself from myself. I'm not going to do the math and try to calculate what they're going to say so I can come back with something witty and funny. I am going to continue to attempt to understand where they're coming from. And the only way I can do that is by asking questions. And sometimes those questions are just pure curiosity. Like you mentioned something, you said X, what did you mean by that? Boom, we go another layer deeper. And so there's vulnerability in that, because now I don't have control of the conversation. I am turning myself over to you. We are connected at that moment. And now we're listening. Mm-hmm. Now I'm listening. And ultimately, the risk with that, which maybe I'm saying risk maybe in a neutral form, is because we've connected so deeply and because that type of interaction is so rare, I am going to have an emotional connection to you. I'm going to value you at a deeper level, and I'm going to miss you, and missing you hurts. Mm-hmm. And so there's the vulnerability.
There you go. Wow, that's amazing. Because that hits right on the topic that we talk about, which is kind of this enlightenment, you know, and that's certainly a question we want to ask you as well, too. You know, is there a significant moment of enlightenment? But when you're sharing that vulnerability, that's one reason we steered the podcast towards Never Split the Difference to begin with, because it's not a book just about negotiations. And as we cover just about every episode, it's different tricks on learning how to listen. And that's one thing, man, I've got to give you a nod for, a shout out. I don't know. How do you do it? Verbally, woohoo! I don't know, but you,
I'm doing it.
Nobody's like watching.
Dazs, the whole thing.
Yeah, yeah, we're not as fancy on YouTube like Jesse is. Okay, so we're not.
Well, we got faces for radio, so we'll stick there.
We're gonna work on that one. But your when you talk about vulnerability as a tool for listening, that's, to me, that's mind-blowing right there, because that's powerful. Because we've talked about a lot of different tools, but I never thought of it as that vulnerability portion being a tool or as needed, just a requirement to be able to listen.
So, yeah, just to be able to, like, remove your own ego from the equation and just sit down and be... I don't mean this in a weird way, but, like, right, their communication has to be able to penetrate through, like, whatever you've got going on, right? So if you can drop those shields, we talked about the different sides of the brain, right? You got to be able to drop that side of the brain, you got to be able to listen. And it's the same kind of a thing, right? If that's you being vulnerable, however it goes. But you just got to be able to listen. Quality answer, by the way, Jesse. I appreciate that.
Thank you, my man. You know, as we're talking, I think vulnerability is more of a condition than a tool.
Got it.
Okay.
I like that.
Could you expand on that? Tell us more.
Ooh, man. That was good. That was real good. You know, I'm going to go to like a construction example. You've probably attempted to practice LPS on projects. Mm-hmm. I know in my experience, I've done the same. And I've been on projects where they're doing the last planner system and everybody hates each other. It's a miserable experience. The only difference is they're doing it with stickies. Yeah.
So real quick, fill everybody in. What's LPS mean?
So last planner system, LPS stands for the last planner systems. It's a production scheduling system, if you will. It's collaborative planning that integrates the expertise of everybody on the job site.
Understood. Sorry.
Good. And so the conditions on that project or those types of projects, the conditions are such that whatever tool you want to use is not going to reap a pleasurable experience because there's low trust, there's backbiting, there's no candid communication. So the conditions are not in place for that thing to flourish. You bring the same system into another environment with different conditions where people trust, where people are open, where people are curious, where people are willing to take risks. And that system, I'm using Last Planner system as a reference, but Scrum, TAC, any of the systems will reap greater results because the conditions are in place for that thing to flourish.
Yeah, like a basic foundation to begin with, right? The foundation's got to be there for any kind of a system to succeed.
Yeah, and part of that last planner, and just so you know, all of our listeners in Texas, we have a lot of them. Thank you, Jesse, very much. Thank you to everybody that's in Texas. They all know exactly what his terminology is, but this is for everybody else, right, to understand kind of last planner.
This is for the other baristas that are listening out there.
There is at least another barista listening maybe in Germany.
Yeah,
we have no idea.
Or New Zealand.
But I did want to ask you that question is, what's a significant moment for you where you had an enlightenment, where you realized, one, communication happened, or maybe you just realized kind of a new idea, you know, a new thought on how to communicate?
Oh, man. So there's two, but I'm going to stick to one. It was, I don't know if you're familiar with David Verbal. He's a lean Yoda. He's amazing.
I was like, so we got wizards, we got space wizards. All right, I'm into it.
Oh, you're tying in. Yeah, damn, you connected with my co-host here. Keep going.
I know, I've been listening, bro. I've been listening. So he runs this exercise. I was at a lean transformation summit or something. We're in Seattle, and the language on the flyer said humble inquiry. I was like, okay, this sounds interesting. Let me go check that out. And then, you know, we talk about what humble inquiry is, and, you know, as simple as I can get description of what humble inquiry is asking the questions to which you do not have the answer for. Now, in this seminar, there's an exercise, and I don't know the official name for it, but I call it the triad. And so there's three people. One person is the problem owner. One person is the coach. And the third person is the observer. And so the problem owner, they say James is the problem owner, and he's just saying this is what, you know, whatever he's dealing with.
Okay.
Brandon, you're the coach. And your job is only to ask him questions. No leading questions, no closed-ended questions, no statements with like a question mark at the end, and no sneaky tells.
All right.
Yep. And my job as the observer is to take note of all the questions that you're asking and the reactions that James has to those questions. It's an amazing thing. We just started doing a little experiment with Adam and Jen and Kirby and Sean Moran, and we're working to build that vulnerability and the capability of listening and asking questions. Anyways, the awakening I had during that, because I've seen many people go through it since then, is especially leaders, people that have direct reports. They recognize all of a sudden that they suck at listening and asking questions because of just the programming that we have, that you're in charge, you have seniority, you have responsibility, you have a title, so you got to have all the answers. Mm-hmm. So they cannot listen to the person in front of them without jumping to a conclusion and giving answers and giving direction and giving advice. And why is that a problem? The reason it's a problem is because if that's your mode of functioning, you end up building dependency on your people, and you don't help your people develop and grow to understand and make their own decisions. Because now you're the source of every answer to every problem. What are they going to do next time? They're going to come back to you. They're going to come back to you. And then you're going to say, damn it, I'm surrounded with people that I wish would take initiative. Well, sure, if you'd let them, but you never did. So that's the awakening that I had around that.
Wow. And so what I heard here, too, is when you were first a plumber, were you the best plumber that ever happened? Like, were you the best guy
in the job on day one? I'm the best thing that happened to plumbing since water.
That's what I say about my being a barista. There you go.
Well, for me, when I started in construction, I didn't know what I was doing. And by repetition and by practice and by learning, I became a better skilled person. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and I shared with Jesse. Jesse, let me share my story a little bit. You know, I wanted to be the best that I could at every level. I wanted to be the best apprentice. I wanted to be the best welder. I wanted to learn the facets of the trade, but it took practice and repetition. And one thing we don't do, and what you just told me you're doing, you're practicing talking. You're practicing listening. And those are all things that I don't think we do enough of to really get better at it. And it needs to happen not just in these conversations, but you know, I know certainly we're getting better, right?
Oh, yeah.
Just in our podcast. And you shared that as well, too. You know, you've seen that growth as well, too. But to sit and do a scenario where you're practicing listening, like that's what a way to amplify your tools. I mean, it's the same as building something, right? You're building 100%. A tool. So, man, that's an amazing enlightenment.
When I was like, my bigger takeaway is so it sounds really dumb, right? That like a leader needs to listen, because ideally the leader is the one that's out there, like, I won't say barking orders, right? But like you're delivering the speech. You think of a president as a leader, right? Well, you're listening to the president, not the president necessarily listening to you. And the big point about that is that it's actually no, like someone's got to get out there and someone's got to ask the right questions to the right people. And they have to be able to like listen, that way they can understand the situation properly and then properly go forward. So that's, I was like, the leader aspect of that one was my big takeaway from that. That's actually, I'm working with a bunch of people right now that are relative rookies and they're not doing what I need them to do. And you know, and I'm pretty good about like swatting hands and I'm like, no, don't you be doing none of that and yada, yada, yada. And I think it's the same kind of thing. Brandon's going to have to shut up every now and then and maybe just like listen or ask better questions. So like, thank you, Jesse. I appreciate that.
Here's another one for you. Is this something, because now I function as a coach mostly. And another one that David Verbal imparted to me said, if the learner hasn't learned, the teacher hasn't taught.
There you go. Very good. That's a quality quote. James is writing that one down.
I am. I'm a quote guy. He knows that.
There you go. I should get you a quote calendar. I'm going to have to do that. All right.
Ooh.
Keep that. Yes. You forget that I said that when the quote calendar comes like knocking on your door.
I'll act surprised.
Okay.
I won't remember this anyways.
So when we're practicing our communication, practice on like your surprise reactions. Have at least three in the can. That way, like when it comes out, I'll be surprised to hear if it says reaction.
I've got two kids, and for 27 Christmases,
okay,
I was as surprised as they were getting their gifts, because I had not, I didn't know what they were getting. I know how to act the surprise thing.
Got it down. All right, good to know.
That's good. That's good.
All right. Well, Jesse, one thing that we want to talk about is your impact on the world. What impact does Jesse want to leave with the Uncommon Communicator world?
Man, that's a tough, that's kind of a tough one, and it's a big, gigantic one. You know what? It's kind of simple. Right? Is we can change the world one world at a time. And what that means is we all have the privilege to influence everybody and anybody. And I don't mean, you know, teaching people how to build a business. I mean, sometimes it's as simple as eye contact and a smile. You can transform somebody's day with a smile. And so with the idea that we can change the world one world at a time, there is a responsibility that comes with that, to kind of like we talked about earlier, to disassociate from myself and whatever I'm whining about and be present and ready to serve. And so when we serve others, it's contagious. It continues to happen. We've been blessed with gifts and talents, and our purpose is to share them, whatever they are. When we share our gifts and talents, we are appropriately serving. When we are appropriately serving, we are changing the world for that one human being that's in front of us, and we all have the capability of doing that.
Wow, that's amazing.
So, did I ever tell you the starfish story?
Yes. Oh. No, like, say it, say it.
Okay, Eagle Scout here. So I get told this one by a Scoutmaster one day. And I get a lot of flack from my friends, because it's like, this is one of my favorite stories. And like, it's kind of the way that I approach a lot of things at work, right? Like, look, I get that all I'm doing is like making a latte and I'm handing it off to you, but you do it with like a smile and you tell somebody to have a good day. And dude, they could have gotten pulled over by a cop on the way into work, right? And then at the same time, in that one little moment, like, everything can get better after that. But here's where the starfish story comes in, right? So massive like tropical storm happens, and we're just going to use Hawaii because Hawaii is an SL spot, right? So massive tropical storm happens in Hawaii, and with tropical storms, obviously stuff from the ocean gets like washed up onto shore, right? There is a massive amount of starfish on this beach, and like we're thousands, right? Like this beach has as many like grains of sand as it does starfish. And there's just one, again, because this is Scouts, it's always a young gentleman. It's never like an old man, it's always a young gentleman. Who's just walking down the beach, and he's just tossing these starfish back into the ocean, right? And again, this is a massive tropical storm, so there's a lot of like headaches, a lot of panic, and a lot of other things going on. And this gentleman walks up to him, and he's wondering what this kid's doing. He's like, dude, you're just tossing them back. You could be here for 10 years and not even make a dent in all these starfishes, right? And he's like, there's no way you're going to make a difference. And the young gentleman picks up another starfish, throws in the ocean, goes, made a difference to that one. And like, and so, and that's the way, again, same thing, right? Like, I can't fix anybody like a latte and pretend that's going to do it. But like, if it makes a difference in that one moment, that's all you can ask for.
That's all that matters.
That's all that matters.
Yep.
That's that making those connections with those people. That's making that communication. Cause if it changes the rest of the day, man, like that's exactly what you need.
Sure.
So yeah. Got it. Jesse's got that starfish story, man. Good to know. You're like one of the first people I know that knows that story. Way to go, bro.
Love it.
Well, and I got to say that on that starfish story, Jesse, absolutely appreciate you coming on our show. You have no idea how much impact you've had on me. And that the whole thing is that's we're going to call it Jesse the Starfish Story.
Okay.
Because you are doing that every day. Jesse's making an impact on people. Jesse, Jen, that whole, I've been now part of a tribe. I'm a member of a tribe.
Okay.
Of people who is growing, which my next question was going to be, when is it now a city? Like, are we going to have to like organize some kind of government because the tribe is growing so fast? But it's the fact is we are all making impacts on each other.
Before you go, I'm going to steal this from But First We Feast and or Hot One specifically. So, Jesse, we'll give you a chance. They say roll out the red carpet. So we're going to roll out the proverbial red carpet here. What do you got coming up going on in your podcast? I heard something about a book. Like, what do you need our listeners to know about Jesse and what's going on with Jesse?
Oh, man. Thank you for that. This huge opportunity. So one, James mentioned the tribe. That's the no BS tribe. And when we redefine what that is, that'll be dictated by all the participants as it continues to grow and as they continue to feed into it. It's not mine. It's not Jen's. It's all of ours. We're live streaming every other Saturday, LinkedIn, YouTube, all the stuff. Got the Learnings and Missteps podcast. You can find that at learningsandmissteps.com. And like the super awesome, we were talking about vulnerability earlier, right? We're fixing to publish a book, and the name of the book is called Lean and Love, based on 5S love letters. So that's going to be coming out, and that's all about relationships, about communication, and largely based on a lot of my own missteps in where I kind of discovered the value of vulnerability and connection and listening. I haven't always been a good listener, so that's coming up, man. A couple of weeks away. I'm excited about it.
Do you have an exact release date, just for the listeners to know?
The target date is February 18th.
Okay. Hey, that's actually the same day that the mask mandate in Jefferson County gets listed. Dude, this is going to be a great day. Quality.
Yeah, we're working through some, final edits. I've learned, let me tell you, there is some work to be done when you're putting that book out there. And I recommend getting some coaching help. I had Miss Kim White carrying me, holding my hand through the whole darn thing. And I'm grateful to her for that, because it would not be what it is without her. And Jen, of course, because Jen trusted me enough to go live with me with a very sketchy kind of 1, 2, 3 bullet point plan. And here we are, 6 months later.
So James has been learning plenty about bullet points here.
I have.
So I got one more question. And this was just a little bit of a fun one. So we went over one of my communication missteps, major misstep, actually. I killed my great aunt for about 6 hours one day. and you always said that, like, you do your best learning, like, after you've kind of messed something up or in your missteps. What's, like, this can be fun, this can be serious, so take your pick with this one. What's a communication misstep, such as killing your great aunt for 6 hours, that, like, you have learned greatly from? Or what's, like, a communication story that you need to tell people?
Yeah, so the communication misstep, and it's not like it wasn't a one-timer. I'm a pretty fast learner, but I'm a faster forgetter.
Okay.
And so the communication misstep that I've replayed over, and I still work to manage that, is giving unsolicited advice.
Oh, okay.
Right. Like, people will come up to me and sometimes they just want to vent. They just, mm-hmm. they just want to talk, and they start telling me about what they're going on. Like, oh, well, you should try this. And there's this app and I start barfing. And then I could see them kind of glaze over. And then, man, I really helped that person out. And then I see them and they're still struggling with the deal. And I'm like, did you try any of the stuff that we talked about? And they don't even remember it. And I'm getting my feelings hurt, because they're not taking my advice. Well, they didn't ask for it. I mean, think about it. Mm-hmm. I go to a restaurant and I get to pick what's on the menu. They don't come and serve me what the hell they want to serve me.
Good call.
That's what I do to people when I'm giving unsolicited advice.
Very good. That's a good one. I never thought about it. Also, just on a side note, if you guys haven't seen the video, it's not the nail. Give it a shout out. It relates to unsolicited advice. Jesse, you seen that one too?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, cool. Yeah.
It's not the nail, man. That one slaps every time. I showed that one to Megan, I think, relatively one of the first times we were dating. And every now and then when she comes home, like after a not great day at work, it's like Brandon just like zipped the lip and just like, uh-huh. Yeah, dude. Because every time, I'm the same kind of way, Jesse. Like, I'm like, no. If you all do this, it'll be fine. Like, let's go. And it's like, nah, man. Sometimes you just got to, like, just zip it. Just ain't nothing mm-hmm. going to make it, but just zip it. So,
yeah. Quality. Or if you want, like, gold points, ask them. And I've learned this, like, are you venting? Do you just want to vent, or are you looking for some direction? Like, how can I serve you in this moment? Mm-hmm. And sometimes I'm like, nah, bro, I just want to vent. All right, cool. And then zip, and we're good.
I was like, pop up in the beer and just like, lay it on me. Let's go. Yep, I feel that exactly, man.
That's good stuff.
Well, thank you, Jesse. And I will also say our little sign off every single week and or every single time we record is see you bye. We have to make full eye contact every time. Otherwise, our timing is completely off.
And we're inviting you as our first guest to join us in our sign off. So we're all making eye contact together.
All right.
Okay. That is all we have for today.
See you bye.